Taxonomy. Hawks are in the class Avis. They are one of the groups in the order Falciformes, and they are in the family Accipitridae. One of the subspecies, the Accipitrinae, has the genus group Accipiter, and the other subspecies group, Budionae, has the genus group Budio. And in this documentary, we will focus on two groups of genuses. One is the Accipiter, and two, the Budio. For basic biology, hawks have similar characteristics to other birds. They are bipedal, meaning they use two legs for walking, warm-blooded, oviparous, meaning that they will lay eggs and the young will hatch out of those eggs, and they also contain feathers and hollow bones. In regards to anatomical terminology, Anita the Falconer does a really great job of showing some notable anatomical features that are very important to point out. Afterwards, I will then further discuss some of the other essential components as well.
All raptors have curved beak. All raptors have extremely sharp toenails, talons, and this middle toe, it has a razor sharp edge to it, and that's to drive it in. Their power is in their back toe, it's called their hallux, but this middle toe has the edge that just drives it in, and that's where all their power is in those two toes. These two just stabilize. So they always have three toes in front, one toe in the back when they're catching stuff. They all have that curved beak, like I said, and that's for ripping their food apart. Falcons actually have a notch in their beak that is perfect for going between vertebrae and severing the spinal cord if they don't kill it midair, because they smack really hard. And then if you look inside of his nostril, see that weird cone thing that he has? That is called an operculum, and it is there for when they are diving that they don't get a rush of air up their nose.
All right, thank you so much. And for the rest of you here, welcome back. Now on to hearing, smell, and eyesight. Hawks have acute hearing but have a poor sense of smell. When it comes to their eyesight, hawks have excellent vision, which is primarily used for hunting. With binocular vision, their vision acuity is just incredible, and they're capable of distinguishing prey 2 to 3 times the distance than a human being if detecting the same creature. Similar to other birds, hawks cannot blink. Instead, they have upper and lower eyelids termed the true eyelids, which are typically covered with a thin layer of feathers. During nighttime hours, the lower eyelid does cover the eye. In addition to the true eyelids, they also have a quote-unquote third eyelid. Really, the third eyelid is a translucent nicotine membrane, which sweeps horizontally across the eyelid at a fairly quickly rate. It moves quickly for the actual true eyelids to remain open and unseen. Usually, the third eyelid assists in cleaning the eyeball, but is also used as a protective layer for injury. Onto wing anatomy. From this image over here, it is noticeable to know that the wings are covered in feathers and also some of the external anatomy of what the wing is comprised of. Based on the composition, it is essential to know of the two genus groups of hawks that I mentioned earlier, the Accipiters and also the Budios. Accipiters, also known as forest-dwelling hawks, have short, wide wings and long rudder-like tails for maneuvering within trees and other narrow areas. These groups of hawks like to inhabit in densely forested areas in the summer or semi-open habitats year-round. However, some of them can become adaptable to suburban areas. Budios, on the other hand, are the opposite. They have long, broad, rounded wings and short, rounded tails, and in terms of their habitats, it's quite wide-ranging, and mostly these are the most common groups of hawks in North America, where they really like apparent sightings for ideal hunting grounds and for soaring. If we consider hawks on the trophic level pyramid, they are deemed to be quaternary and tertiary consumers. Generally carnivorous, they are specifically opportunistic, and depending on the species, the diet does vary. The majority of their diet does comprise of small mammals and rodents. However, they are also open to other groups of organisms as well, such as reptiles, smaller birds, insects, and crustaceans. One of the behavioral elements that they have is known as intestine rejection. And what this hawk is doing is that before consumption of its prey, it is removing and completely discarding the intestine. Another element is after it has consumed its prey, bones and furs are very typically hard to digest, and in order to get rid of these digestible parts, they do regurgitate a pellet known as the cast, which will be removed every 1 to 2 days. And this image just shows of the detailed components of this material, and if you were to ever encounter one of these casts, please do not do what this man is doing. Be sanitary and wear gloves. Hawks are diurnal, meaning that they will hunt during daylight hours and become inactive at night. They have various abilities in obtaining their prey and take advantage of these opportunities for hunting. One is in the air, where they will glide and soar in a left and right motion in order to conserve energy and to scout their territory. Once they do note their prey, they will then hover for a few seconds, push back their wingtips, but really lunge their feet forward, allowing their talons to latch, catch, and obtain their prey. If successful, they will continue to hover and look down for a few seconds. However, these hawks are incredible divers, and depending on the species, some can dive up to 240 kilometers, equivalent to 150 miles per hour. Another form of hunting is on ground, as shown in this image. In this case, the hawk will sit and wait, often on an elevated perch, such as a tree, a post, or any other stable structure. And once they find their lovely meal of choice, they will then use the same technique as in air, where their wingtips will be pushed back and their feet will be lunged forward, allowing their talons to latch and catch onto prey. Hawk reproduction is monogamous, indicating that they have the same mating partner for life, usually 1 month for breeding, which is in February. Stick nests, like the one here, is constructed above ground. After construction, the same nest will be used every year during the breeding season, which occurs in March and April, until one of the two of the pair dies, and then the other will seek another mate elsewhere. Female hawks can lay 1 to 5 eggs, depending on species, every year. She will then typically become responsible for incubating the eggs. However, in the case of the red-tailed hawks, both of the partners do take responsibility in incubation. An incubation will last for 4 to 5 weeks. Once the eggs hatch in about 28 to 35 days, the young are then fed. The chicks grow and fledge fairly quickly, and fledging will occur for 42 to 48 days. However, after the fledging period does remain over, they will stay with their parents for another 30 to 70 days in order to practice and refine any of the following skills, like hunting, flying, and others, until they are fully ready to leave the nest.
Hey Colin, you want to go shoot some hawks today? I've really been craving some hawkos.
Although a hawko sounds pretty good, the laws and regulations surrounding harvesting a hawk are quite strict. Hi, I'm Colin, and I want to make you aware of the laws surrounding hawks before you go out and make your own hawko. The Migratory Bird Treaty Act prohibits any person from taking, possessing, purchasing, bartering, and selling raptors unless you have a federal permit to do so. It is a federal crime to touch or possess any part of a hawk, even a feather. If you're caught with any evidence, you can be punished with up to $15,000 in fine or imprisonment.
Dadgummit. There goes my million-dollar idea of opening up my own Taco Bell. But wait, if we aren't allowed to possess a hawk, then what are the laws falconers have to abide by, and how were we able to hold hawks when the falconer came into our lab?
Legally, we are allowed to hold and practice flying hawks as long as we're under the supervision of someone with a permit. To get your own hawks, the first step you need to take is passing the falconry exam. Once you've done that, you need to find a sponsor that's either a third-year general falconer or a master falconer. After you found your sponsor and submitted the apprentice falconer application, you are good to go out and trap your own kestrel or an immature red-tailed hawk.
Oh wow, I didn't realize how tedious the process to fly and own a hawk was.
Finishing an apprenticeship takes 2 years, and it takes 7 years to become a master falconer. It takes real time and dedication and a love for these birds to become a falconer, which is why they cost so much money to implement in an agricultural setting.
Red-tailed and Cooper's hawks are opportunistic hunters, making cute backyard birds, pets, and small livestock easy meals for them. Any good poultry farmer knows that humans aren't the only ones that like a good chicken meal. This is why certain species of hawks have commonly been referred to as chicken hawks or cock hawks. Large concentrations of birds without cover can make them vulnerable to predation from various animals. The severity of hawk attacks on poultry can change with the seasons, increasing during the winter, when food is scarce, or in the early summer, when fledglings are practicing their hunting skills. In order to understand how to manage the problem of poultry losses in agriculture, it is important to know what kind of animal is preying on your chickens. This requires some investigation to find the culprit and create the necessary precautions to maximize production. Hawks will usually attack during the day, so that they can easily be spotted circling overhead on a potential target site. Other signs of hawks preying on poultry include talon puncture wounds on the carcass's back and breasts, plucked feathers in a circular pile, and splashed or streaked whitewash defecation at the kill site. So what can be done to reduce the risk of human-wildlife conflict with pest hawks? Well, for poultry farming, exclusion is the best way to go about it. Any enclosed structure, such as this one, with a durable cover, netting, or chicken wire provide great protection. Modifying surrounding habitat can also be effective, such as creating more exposure by removing potential perches, such as trees and poles, that they can use to strike from. While hawks provide numerous benefits to agriculture in terms of controlling pest rodents and birds, they can also be considered pests themselves. The two main ways that hawks can create a human-wildlife conflict is in predation of domestic animals and as an aircraft risk for bird strikes. According to the USDA's Animal and Plant Health Inspection Service, hawks have the highest risk rating of any bird for bird strikes, causing $17.7 million in damage between 2010 and 2015. To prevent this, hawks may be removed by either relocation or killing. Although hawks are federally protected, depredation permits may be authorized if they are creating very serious problems, such as significant threats to aircraft, in which case they may be shot with nothing larger than a 12-gauge shotgun.
Falconry is getting more popular as a solution in agriculture as farmers are trying to look for an effective, long-term solution for vertebrate pest management. Farmers can hire falconers that offer bird pest control in agriculture, landfills, resorts, etc. We can see bird damage in most of the agricultural commodities, but some of the most affected are grapes, blueberries, strawberries, and cherries. We can find hawks in the nature too, and the two most common species that you will find in the fields are the red-tailed and Cooper's hawk. Their diet includes small mammals like mice, rats, gophers, squirrels, and more. Some hawks will even chase and feed on bird pests like sparrows, starlings, blackbirds, pigeons, and more. Preserving large trees and installing artificial perches will facilitate hawks' presence and nesting, since most raptor species rely on perches for hunting, resting, and roosting. Hawks will soar or perch on trees or structures waiting for prey. They need a large hunting area with several scattered perches. A final note is that hawks are susceptible to secondary poisoning because they feed on small rodents that are often controlled with anticoagulant rodenticides.
This is going to be a quick plan on how to build an artificial perch for raptors. First, we're going to aim for a perch height between 17 to 15 feet. In this example, we are going to use two 10-foot galvanized steel pipes that are going to be 3 feet below ground filled with half bag of ready-mixed concrete. The two pipes are going to be held together using a threaded sleeve, and a good block is going to be held to the pipes with a round floor type flange. Finally, a quick note is that you're going to install the perch in an open area, away from power lines and trees.